हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, हाउ आर यू ऑल? होप यू आर डूइंग वेल इन दिस पैंडमिक सिचुएशन एंड स्टेइंग हेल्दी. सो दिस इज़ योर केमिस्ट्री लेक्चरर स्वतंत्र कुमार जायसवाल, एंड टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस क्वालिटेटिव ऑर्गेनिक एनालिसिस, क्वालिटेटिव एनालिसिस ऑफ ऑर्गेनिक कंपाउंड्स. सो दिस साउंड्स लाइक स्टडिंग क्वालिटी ऑफ द ऑर्गेनिक कंपाउंड्स, राइट? इफ़ यू सी एन ऑर्गेनिक कंपाउंड लाइक बेंजीन, so benzene can contains two types of elements. What kind of these are? Like carbon and hydrogen. Carbon and hydrogen, and also different compounds contain different elements like carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur, phosphorus, and halogens. Chlorine, bromine, fluorine, and iodine, etc. Right? So if we substitute this benzene ring with a group that is nitro, so this is now nitrobenzene, and it contains additionally two elements, nitrogen and oxygen. Right? So now we have four elements. Let us substitute it with another group which creates more number of elements. So what else we can do? We can substitute one more group, that is SH thiol group, right? So now we have five types of elements. Right? Let's substitute with another group. So what it would be? Let us substitute it with chlorine, right? We are substituting the hydrogens here. First I substituted nitro group, then I substituted thiol group SH, then I substituted at last halogen, that is chlorine, right? So we see now we have six types of elements, right? So in this video we are going to study qualitative analysis of organic compounds, where we have to study carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur and chlorine, right? So let us start with the very initial carbon and hydrogen. Right, so in this compound we have carbon and hydrogen, we all know, right? So if we add in this compound cupric oxide, that is CuO, right? So what we are gonna get? Carbon dioxide plus, if we use two equivalents, then two Cu, right? So what we got after the adding of cupric oxide pellets, we got carbon dioxide and copper elemental, right? If we have hydrogen, then again let's add this copper cupric oxide pellets, and what we get here is water plus elemental copper, right? So how would be knowing that these compounds are getting formed with this initial compound, right? Carbon dioxide and water. We treated cupric oxide with carbon, which we have in this compound, and cupric oxide also added in this compound, which contains hydrogen also, right? So we got carbon dioxide and water. So how we are gonna test it? For carbon dioxide, I am going to add lime water, that is calcium hydroxide, right? Carbon dioxide plus calcium hydroxide. So what it gives, we all know, calcium
कार्बोनेट,
राइट? दिस इज मिल्की व्हाइट टर्बिडिटी विच प्रोड्यूस्ड बिटवीन द रिएक्शन विथ कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड एंड कैल्शियम हाइड्रोक्साइड, एंड दिस कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड वॉज लिबरेटेड ड्यूरिंग द रिएक्शन ऑफ कार्बन विथ क्यूप्रिक ऑक्साइड. सो कैल्शियम कार्बोनेट एंड इट गिव्स व्हाइट मिल्की टर्बिडिटी विच कन्फर्म्स द प्रेजेंस ऑफ कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड एज वेल एज प्रेजेंस ऑफ कार्बन इन दिस कंपाउंड, राइट? एंड सेम वी आर गोइंग टू डू फॉर दिस वॉटर. फॉर दिस वॉटर वी आर गोइंग टू डू H2O वी हैव, राइट? लेट्स एड सम एनहाइड्रस कॉपर सल्फेट इन दिस कंपाउंड, राइट? एनहाइड्र इट शुड बी एनहाइड्रस. So what we are going to get, we all know copper sulfate when reacts with water, it produces copper sulfate dot 5S2, right? CuSO4 dot 5S2O. We all can say that this is the aqueous solution of copper sulfate, whose color is blue. What color it produces? It produces blue color, right? So we confirm here that there was water initially, and also we confirm that there was hydrogen in the initial compound, right? So this was the test of carbon, detection of carbon, and later on detection of hydrogen. How we detected? Carbon dioxide are treated with calcium hydroxide, which produces further calcium carbonate white milky turbidity. And when we treated water with anhydrous copper sulfate, it produced copper sulfate, that is hydrous, that is copper sulfate dot 5S2O, aqueous solution of copper sulfate, which is blue in color, which confirms the presence of hydrogen in the initial compound, right? So this was all about the carbon and hydrogen. So let's move further, and we'll detect the nitrogen. The other element would be nitrogen. So now I'm going to start detection of nitrogen. So how we will come to know that nitrogen is present in this compound, right? In this compound, nitrogen is bonded with this benzene ring covalently or in the ionic form. Of course, you can see it is in the covalent form, right? So first, to test the nitrogen, there is a special test called Lassaigne's test. Lassaigne test detects nitrogen, sulfur, halogens, and phosphorus, right? We'll discuss phosphorus later. So in this Lassaigne test, we'll discuss nitrogen, sulfur, and halogen, right? So let's start with the nitrogen. So what comprises the Lassaigne test? First of all, we are going to convert this covalently bonded nitrogen, halogen, or sulfur into ionic form. First of all, what we are going to do, convert this nitrogen, chlorine, or sulfur into ionic form. So how we'll do that? There's something called ignition tube. I'm not good at drawing pictures, so you can understand roughly. So this is a ignition tube, and we are going to add some sodium into it. What is that? Sodium, right? Sodium. Take some sodium in an ignition tube, and further what we'll do, we'll add one pinch of that organic compound which contains your nitrogen. Right? So what we did, first we took sodium in an ignition tube, and later on added one pinch of organic compound in this ignition tube. So what happens, whether it is about nitrogen or chlorine or different halogens or about sulfur. So what happens when sodium reacts with the compound? So let's see, it is in a chemical reaction. When sodium reacts with a compound which contains carbon and nitrogen, so what happens? I already told you that we have to convert this carbon nitrogen covalent bond into anionic form, right? So let's do this reaction. What we did, we took sodium in an ignition tube, and already carbon and nitrogen is already present in this organic compound. So what happens when we heat this mixture? It produces sodium cyanide, right? This compound is now anionic, which contains free cyanide ions, right? So likewise we can do this for chlorine and sulfur also. Let's say about sulfur. Sodium when reacts with sulfur, upon heating this, it produces sodium sulfide, Na2S, right? Here sulfide is also in the anionic form, free form, right? And also this we can do for halogens. In halogens, what happens? When we take sodium and chlorine together, there will be some release of energy and there will be formation of NaCl, right? NaCl, that is free chloride ion. Right? Okay. So first we converted all the covalently bonded elements, nitrogen, chlorine and sulfur, into ionic form. So now we are free to test it, like we are free to react these ions with another ion. Okay. If you are going to detect nitrogen, then we saw that there must be carbon and nitrogen in order to get the cyanide ion, right? Cyanide ion. So what we are going to do, we prepared sodium fusion extract in an ignition tube what we have, where we had sodium along with the carbon and nitrogen that is in this compound, right? This is, let's break it in a china dish. What we are going to do, this ignition tube, which is red hot with compound and sodium, this is red hot, we have heated it, and now let's fuse it into some distilled water. We have distilled water already in this china tube, porcelain disc. This is what called porcelain disc, or you can say china disc. Right? So let's add this red hot ignition tube, or let's break this red hot ignition tube after adding this into this china disc. Right? So now what we get is called sodium fusion extract. Sodium fusion extract. Right? So what we prepared in this china dish is what called sodium fusion extract. So further, this sodium fusion extract actually contains this free cyanide ion. Right? This free cyanide ion. And if we break this ignition tube in this china disc, one part will be the residue and other part will be the filtrate, right? So we are going to collect that filtrate part and throw that residue part, because it might be containing that broken glasses and some impurity, right? So let's get rid of that residue and collect this filtrate. We are going to collect this filtrate. And this is your sodium fusion extract, right? Further, we will be tasting with this only sodium fusion extract. So remember it, in salt we can call it SFE, sodium fusion extract. Okay. So once this sodium fusion extract is ready, we are also ready to taste the nitrogen, right? So what we have, free cyanide ion in this filtrate of sodium fusion extract, right? Cyanide ion, we are going to add some ferrous sulfate in this sodium fusion extract. What we are going to add? Ferrous sulfate, right? Ferrous sulfate means it contains iron second ions, and what we get here is called FeCn6 4-. What is the name of this compound? We all know sodium. If sodium is present, then we can say this is in the ionic form, so we can write it hexa, because there is a 6 number of ligands, to hexa cyano ferrate. Why? Because of this negative charge, ferrate. And which and there is oxidation state, in which oxidation state iron is there? In the second. Okay, so this is what called hexa cyano ferrate, right? Once we got this hexa cyano ferrate, we are going to acidify this sodium fusion extract with some amount of concentrated sulfuric acid, right? We have bought this hexa cyano ferrate, right? So we are going to acidify this sodium fusion extract with some amount of concentrated sulfuric acid. Sulfur, being in the highest oxidation state, acts as an oxidizing agent. So what we have added earlier is iron second, ferrous sulfate. Now this ferrous ions will convert itself into ferric ions, that is in the iron third oxidation state. So now we have this iron third and hexa cyano ferrate. So what happens when we treat this hexa cyano ferrate with this iron third ion? What produced in the during the course of the reaction is another complex. What is that complex? Let's write it over here. It's Fe4FeCn6 3 .xH2O, because there might be some water, that's why I wrote it .xH2O. So you can see this is a complex coordination compound which contains Fe4 in iron second iron third oxidation state, and inside the coordination sphere in iron second iron, which is outside the coordination sphere, is in iron third oxidation state, and the iron which is inside the coordination sphere is in iron second oxidation state. Now this is what called Prussian blue. This solution is what called Prussian blue. If there is a formation of this Prussian blue, then we can say very clearly that nitrogen was present in that compound, right? Which we can see it's there. So and also its name is, you know, ferrocyanide, because iron in third oxidation state called ferric and second ferrous. So we can say this is ferrocyanide. We can write it over here. Ferrocyanide, right? So if this color persists, this Prussian blue, then we can clearly say that nitrogen was present in the compound. So let's move on with the sulfur. Now we have detected the nitrogen present in this compound. So let's move on to sulfur. So far we have detected carbon, hydrogen and nitrogen. And now I am going to detect sulfur and also After that, we'll discuss halogens, that is chlorine present in this compound. So one question I'm going to ask you, there's a compound called hydrazine, NH2, NH2, N2, H4, right? This is what called hydrazine. So can you tell me whether this compound gives the taste of nitrogen by the Lassaigne test or not? So as we saw earlier, that to detect the nitrogen, we must be having carbon in that compound in order to convert the nitrogen, which is covalently bonded in this compound, into anionic form. But we don't have, we clearly see there is no carbon in this compound. So we can clearly say that we cannot detect the nitrogen here by this method, right? Because carbon is absent. So this question was asked in J Advanced earlier. That's why I discussed here, mentioned here that this compound hydrazine would not be giving the sodium fusion extract test or Lassaigne test, right? Now move on to the detection of sulfur. Right? If we see about sulfur, we had this earlier, sodium sulfide, Na2S, right? We converted it from covalent form to ionic form. So now we have sulfide ion. So what we are going to do, we have already prepared this sodium fusion extract. We all know in ignition tube, we added sodium and some pinch amount of this organic compound, and we prepared sodium fusion extract by breaking it into a china disc, and we collected that filtrate, and now with that filtrate we are moving on with the test of sulfur. Earlier we detected tested sulfur nitrogen, and now I am going to test or detect sulfur. So how this is going to happen, let's see. In sodium fusion extract, first of all, acidify this with some amount of acetic acid. Right, some amount of acetic acid in this sodium fusion extract we acidified with acetic acid, and now along with this we are going to add lead acetate. Lead acetate, right? So what we have, sulfide plus what else, lead in the second oxidation state. So what would get, PbS, right, which is black colored. So if we get this black precipitate in the course of the reaction, then we can confirm that there was sulfur present in the initial compound. So what we did, first we acidified the sodium fusion extract with acetic acid, and further on we added the lead acetate, that is sulfide plus lead second ion, and we got PbS black. In the course of the reaction, PbS was precipitated. This PbS was precipitated, you know, this, when you will study the group reagent, there is a part in analytical chemistry, group reagents, right? So there also you'll be studying this PbS, how this lead sulfide is gets precipitated, or with which reagent we used to precipitate it out. So for here we need to know this much only. So there is an alternate way to test sulfur, which is which was asked initially in JEE Main and also in NEET or AIPMT examinations. What was that? So first of all, there was a question that if we add sulfide ion, in a solution of sodium nitroprusside, what is that? Na2FeCN5NO. You can see this is a coordination compound, right? Sodium nitroprusside. This is what called sodium nitroprusside, right? When we treat this sulfide ion with the sodium nitroprusside, what we get is a violet colored solution of Na4FeCN5NOS, right? Na4FeCN5NOS, right? So this was asked earlier in JEE Main and also in NEET examination, what we usually get when we treat sulfide ion with sodium nitroprusside. This is violet color solution. If you get this violet color solution, then you can confirm that sulfur was present in the initial compound, right? There is some special case, you know, when we have both sulfur and nitrogen at the same time as in this compound. We can see that nitrogen and sulfur both are available at the same time in this compound. So if we will be having nitrogen and sulfur at the same time, then when we will be preparing sodium fusion extract, we'll add sodium in an ignition tube and we'll be adding this compound, so which contains carbon, sulfur and nitrogen. So when this sodium fusion extract will be prepared, what would be formed here is sodium thiocyanide, NaSCN. To test this NaSCN, what we are going to do, we'll add some iron third ion with this SCN minus, which is in the ionic form, and you will be getting FeSCN twice plus. And also in this compound, there is much reported about it that this FeSCN dot H2O or 2 times H2O, something like that used to be formed, but it is of blue color. A blue color solution would be formed, which will be confirming that there was sulfur and nitrogen both present in that compound, right? And also in this sodium fusion extract, if you add some extra sodium, so what happens, this sodium thiocyanide which was formed, it will decompose into sulfide and cyanide again, and they will give their usual tests. Now we are left with the element chlorine in this compound, and particularly halogens. What kind of halogens we have? We can test with sodium fusion extract. It's chlorine, bromine and iodine. So what we are going to do to test the halogens? So first of all, in the sodium fusion extract, add some amount of dilute nitric acid. What we are going to add? Acidify with some dilute nitric acid, and later on we have to add silver nitrate, that is AgNO3. We have silver first in the free form Ag plus, and already in the sodium fusion extract what we had, NaCl or NaBr or NaI in the ionic form, chloride, bromide and iodide, right? So what happens, Ag plus plus, here we can have Cl minus or Br minus or iodide ion, and we'll get the precipitates AgCl, AgBr and AgI. So how we gonna test these three compounds? This it would be of color AgCl, white precipitate. If there would be chlorine as in this compound, then there would be white PPT when we'll add silver nitrate in the sodium fusion extract. And also if we have bromine, then what we'll get, pale yellow color. And if we have iodide ion, that is silver iodide form, it is completely yellow colored. right? So how we are going to know that this is whether AgCl, AgBr or AgI, there is one more test. We can dissolve them in sodium ammonium hydroxide. What happens when we add ammonium hydroxide to the AgCl? This AgCl precipitate will be completely soluble in sodium ammonium hydroxide solution with NH4OH, completely soluble, right? And what about AgBr? It is sparingly soluble in ammonium hydroxide solution. And what about AgI? It is insoluble in ammonium hydroxide solution. And this is white PPT, this is pale yellow, and this is yellow colored, right? So this is how we are going to test about halogens, chlorine, bromine and iodine. Fluoride comes into the wet test of anions, which right now we are not going to discuss. You'll be studying in the group reagent of analytical part. Okay, so now what we are left with, the phosphorus. Phosphorus is not specifically here in this compound. Let's see how we can test the phosphorus. Detection of phosphorus. First of all, if a compound contains phosphorus, right, contains phosphorus, what we have to do is add some amount of sodium peroxide, which can oxidize this compound which contains phosphorus into phosphate ion. In which ion? Phosphate ion, right? PO4 3-, right? If sodium is there, then sodium phosphate will be formed. So what we have to do now, phosphate, now this is oxidized. First, what we have to do, compound contains phosphorus, treat it with sodium peroxide, which then oxidizing agent will oxidize phosphorus into phosphate ion. Now acidify this phosphate ion with some HNO3, nitric acid. Acidify this with nitric acid, and what we will be get, you will be getting S3PO4, right? This is what called phosphoric acid. And now in this phosphoric acid, we are going to add some amount of sodium ammonium molybdate, NH4, pull twice, MOO4. This is what called ammonium molybdate we added in this S3PO4, which we had acidified earlier, right? So what gets formed here is ammonium phosphomolybdate, NH4 whole thrice, PO4 dot MOO3. This is what called ammonium phosphomolybdate. Right? So this is how we tested phosphorus. We had this compound which contained phosphorus. We treated with some oxidizing agents such as sodium peroxide, and we got phosphorus converted into phosphate, and then we acidified it with dilute nitric acid, and further what we got, this S3PO4 phosphoric acid. Then further we treated this with NH4 whole twice MOO4, that is ammonium molybdate. And finally, what we got is NH4 whole thrice PO4MOO3, that is ammonium phosphomolybdate, and its color is canary yellow. The solution's solution's color will be canary yellow. There is some word, there is a bird, I don't know what its name, but on that bird's name, it is called canary yellow, right? So far we have tested or detected carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur, halogens, in halogens, bromine, chlorine and iodine, and now we have also detected phosphorus. So this was all about the qualitative analysis of organic compounds, that is, we have detected or we have known now, that is, what are the qualities of the elements which are there in a compound, right? So in the next lecture we might be discussing about the quantitative analysis of organic compounds, in which we would see that how can we estimate quantitatively an element like chlorine, hydrogen, carbon, phosphorus, etc., nitrogen, etc., right? Okay, thank you.